Hello, everybody. We're back. It's been a couple weeks. We're back to do episode 7, if you can believe it. We were just talking about that. We're already 7 episodes in. And this is the third episode for Hatful of Hollow.
And who are we?
I don't know. I got amnesia.
Kaz, take it away.
We're the handsome hooligans. can we put fireworks and stuff after that?
Yeah. Can you see? Yes, post production, we're gonna put fireworks. This is Charming Smithscast, the handsome hooligans, the friends of Mike Joyce, and Morrissey, and anybody else we badmouth. I mean, we have nothing against them, but. And look, we got a table.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, we're moving up in the Smithscast world.
That's right. We can afford a table now.
We got a table.
Yeah. And, I was going to give a quick shout out to the comment we got. Nobody has yet to claim the list of the lost book that was up for grabs. If somebody would comment, nobody commented. It was like,
that's on purpose.
It was total science.
That's the thing. They all know better.
Guys, yeah. If you will comment, you can in your comment. You can say, please don't send me the list of the lost. You don't have to take it. I'm not going to force you. But we did get a comment, and this is back on the second one of the first album.
Okay.
Anyway, by a guy named David Brewster, my brother.
Oh.
Hey, he's commenting. This is one of our 2 comments so far, and we're this is 7 episodes in.
Yeah.
So we've gotten 2 comments.
We are tearing it up.
He says, "Well done. I've always enjoyed the eponymous debut."
The hippopotamus debut.
What? I'm the hippopotamus. Yeah, he says, love the country western piano on Reel Around the Fountain. So that, remember you said, there's other good songs too, but probably wasn't the, anyway, he says, the Athena from Zeus's Head. Okay. Keep it up, especially the non sequiturs. I adore the conversational tone and feel like I am in the room.
Well,
thank you.
That's because you are in the room. Welcome, David.
Dave, come on out. No, he said that last time he was yelling at the computer because we couldn't figure out that actor from the collector's Terrence Stamp name.
Yeah, yeah.
He's like, Terrence Stamp! It's Terrence Stamp!
I remembered it eventually.
Yeah, I know, but so the whole time he's been one of those that have watched through all the episodes. So yeah. we're fortunate for that. Anyway, and I got a reveal too.
Oh yeah.
Okay, let's
huge reveal as I roll off the thing.
Oh, oh my gosh!
There it is, baby. I knew I had it.
The Morrissey and the cup.
Oh my gosh, yeah. I knew I had it, but I've been looking all over the house for it. My brother, he heard that episode, it all comes full circle. Look at the vinyl, dude. But
how it says on the cover, Morrissey after the collector.
Yeah.
Oh, who's that one cover actor that... He took the place of Terrence Stamp.
Yeah, what was his name? He sang like, and he ended up having a solo career. No,
Paul McCartney.
Yeah. Oh, what's the writing on?
Yeah, I was just gonna look.
It says, "Don't read me."
Oh wait, there it is.
I think that's just wait. Maybe.
It's there.
But anyway, so he saw that episode where we were talking about it. I was like, I swear I have it. And all of a sudden, he sent me a picture of the vinyl. I was like, you got it. You're the, and he's like, yeah, I got it. And I was like, oh my gosh, this is so awesome.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I don't
there's got to be.
It's just like the regular engravings on there. You know, like
RTT. Dang it.
Yeah.
Maybe, yeah.
But no, that's super cool. Here, actually, what's the, oh yeah, no, this, and this doesn't have the old, like, Capitol building on the Rough Trade logo. You probably can't see that, but before Rough Trade was the, like, box thing.
Yeah, so anyway, that was, like, huge. Oh, and the history of this this album, or this single, I love that picture, he just looks so funny, is that my brother went to Europe back after he got out of high school, backpacked, and he bought this in Belgium, and he backpacked with it through Europe.
Nice.
He bought it for me.
Sweet.
So, anyway.
And then he brought it home and didn't give it to you.
No, he did give it. No, but
he was like, yeah, Mark can come over and listen to it whenever he wants to.
No, you see, because he still had a bunch of records.
Yeah.
And this is one I kept. This is the one. I was like hoping that whenever I pull it out, I'd pull out the record and this charming, or handsome, or Hand in Glove would be, the 7-inch would be in there too.
Yeah.
Somehow I slipped it in. But no.
Yeah.
But anyway.
That's the only
one
I didn't have.
Anyway, that was really cool. I knew I kept that one. So, now we need to talk about. Okay, so we're gonna end this one. This has been a great note. Like, we're already.
So we're still talking about this album here. This one.
Yep.
And it is. We are. Halfway through.
more or less.
Yeah, because a lot. Because actually, the first song we're going to talk about is Still Ill.
Yep, Still Ill.
Do you want to play it?
Yeah.
Might as well put some music in
here.
Yeah,
we might as well just let it play a little bit. Oops.
Oops. Whoa, that's not Still Ill.
Sorry, that was my mistake.
Dude,
well, guys, looks like they found us out.
Yeah, we've never heard this before. Well, there it is, Still Ill, Still Good.
Yeah, it's, we already covered it in the other podcast, but
nope.
But the thing is that it's a nice song. I like it.
Yeah, but it's on the, what's the difference between this one and the one on, does the other one doesn't have the harmonica?
Yeah, the other one.
Anyway, it's pretty similar sounding. I mean,
yeah,
because
the other one has that ch ch ch.
Oh. Yeah. We're all making these weird noises. It doesn't have either one of those noises that we just made. Yeah. Actually, you know what? I might like the first album's version better.
Yeah.
I do like the harmonica on this one, but I like that. If they could, like, combine the two, like, okay, you have the drums from this one.
And just make
the guitar from that one. Yeah, and then Morrissey goes, kuh, 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 kuh.
Yeah, because
Morrissey's the one.
Morrissey's up there standing there going, kuh,
kuh, kuh, kuh, kuh. Like, is he choking? Should I give him the high? Like,
yeah, give him that glass of milk.
That is why all the fans used to rush the stage, just because they thought he was choking. Okay.
Or he's choking. Yeah, great song, and
great song.
Like Kaz said, that it's one that this is like, if you're gonna introduce somebody to the Smiths, it's like, this is one that definitely.
That's
but,
a good one.
But it's a good one. So let's move on.
So
we're just, look at us, we're burning right through.
Yeah.
Heaven knows I'm miserable now.
Okay, this
and
song.
That's not a mistake. So.
Yeah. So.
Okay, so you have something for us.
Oh yeah, okay. I'm sure you guys have heard this.
Yeah.
That that Sandy Shaw, this song's based on a Sandy Shaw song.
Oh yeah. Or at least the title.
Yeah, so. Anyway, so she had a song called Heaven Knows I'm Missing Him Now. And so, I mean, this is just, I wonder if this was originally titled Heaven Knows I'm Missing Her or Him Now. And then he just thought, you know what? I don't write about that kind of stuff. I'm going to say something else.
You know, you bring up a good point. Maybe Morrissey is just stealing all his lyrics.
No, I think it's a nod to
Sandy
Shaw.
I think he's stealing it.
Well, he did borrow a lot of lyrics. He took on loan.
I think was it Morrissey or Oscar Wilde who
said genius genius steal?
What is it? Talent borrows, genius steals.
Yep.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and you know, he puts them into his own. He takes it and kind of. That's the thing is that to be a creative person, you're never gonna invent something totally new. You take something that you inspires you and you tweak it to your own thing. That's just the way it is. And I think this title is just it's a nod to her, but he changed it, you know, to make it fit Morrissey.
Yeah.
You know, he doesn't think about, oh, I'm missing her, I'm doing, you know, it's like, no, just heaven knows I'm miserable now. But it actually, if you interchange the word, you know, all the things he says, you know, like, I was looking for a job and then I found a job and heaven knows I'm missing her now, you know, that it works. Like, he just...
I don't know.
I think. I can't say.
After working for quite a few years, I agree with that sentiment. I was looking for a job, I found a job, and heaven knows I'm miserable now.
Okay. Maybe.
I think that's very interesting, like, he changed it later. No, I think, like, he listened to that song as a teenager and just, like, quickly found, like, a notebook somewhere and wrote, heaven knows I'm miserable now, and then kept that in, like, a closet in his room, and then suddenly when the Smiths surfaced, he was like, oh, look. He was cleaning out his closet.
He had one of these
shoes. Yeah.
Wait. Yeah. Well, I mean, okay. You're okay. But anyway, I think you don't get a song titled "Heaven Knows I'm Miserable Now" and there's one by this lady that you totally adore, you know, Sandy Shaw, called "Heaven Knows I'm Missing Him Now."
No, it's definitely not. But it's not. Like,
yeah, I mean, I wasn't saying it's that he stole it at all. I'm saying you could put that, you know, heaven knows I'm missing him now. He stole it. Morrissey, give it back.
Yeah, you're all right.
We demand 25%
for Sandy Shaw. No, actually, she got 40% whenever, and it was 40% for her and 30% for Joy, Marr and Morrissey whenever she did the single.
And Mike Joyce got 0.005%.
That's what I'm saying. So, you know, you would think that they would have understood, okay, we're getting screwed over here. Is it really fair to, you know? But anyway, whatever. That's a different show because this is the Friends of the Smiths.
This is the Friends of Mike Joyce and Morrissey.
No, the Friends of Johnny Marr and Morrissey if they were upset about... But anyway,
if they're upset about it.
Oh, well, okay. So I'm sorry to go off track.
Okay,
totally.
Let's
talk about the song. Oh, play it again because
play it again,
Sham. Or did we even play it?
I don't think we even played it. Wow.
So heaven knows I'm miserable now.
Okay, but they're
see?
Missing him now.
No.
It could work. Okay.
You're right. I think this song is a bunch of just one-liners. It's not a story.
No, it's not.
It's like, here's a list of all the things that have made me miserable.
Well, yeah, it's just, it's kind of...
I was drunk first, and I was happy then, and now I'm sober.
No, it's like, hey, I was trying to do this, you know, I was looking for a job. Yeah, because then all of a sudden he's like, what she asks of me at the end of the day, Caligula would have blushed.
I wonder what she asked of him.
Well, if it made Caligula
blush... She said was, you've been in the house too long, she said. And I naturally fled. That's what she asked.
I know what that's from.
I know.
It's probably from one of Morrissey's one-night stands where the woman rolls over and says, "What are you still doing here?
What are you still doing here?" Like, I thought you were gone. No, well, no, but it is kind of, it's just saying, you know what, I try to do stuff, I try to do regular stuff, try to work, you know, or even, you know, but I just, I'm not happy.
Yeah.
There you go. But anyway, I love the music for this song.
Yeah.
I love, like, dang it, I don't have it written down. Because there's the part where it kind of does this kind of like, is it in this one? It's kind of this disco-y, like, here, play it a little bit. Because the guitar in this is so good. But it is... Well, you got that, but then it's like...
Here it comes.
And the bass and the guitar, it just, no, but they, there's a part where they kind of double it up too. Here, pause, or dang it.
Yeah, no.
But there's a part where it kind of does double speed too, and it's kind of like a little more like, it's almost like a 70s disco kind of slow feeling to it. I just love the music, and Johnny Marr's so good at that, making it not like so up front in your face, you know, like he doesn't have to have, like he talks about, he doesn't have to have a flash solos and stuff, but he can make this beautiful stuff out of something simple.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, definitely. Well,
do you concur,
yes.
Steve?
Oh, I already said I like the song. I was just going to let Kaz talk because I always talk over him.
Oh,
I know. I noticed that. No, Kaz. serious. Like, I'm like, okay. I'm like, Kaz, what do you think? And I was like, no, Steve, what do you...
Yeah, no. This song is super cool to me because it is like a part of Smith's legend, myth, that Johnny Marr... tricked, who was it, the A&R guy or whatever, into buying him a guitar in New York, and like the moment he opened up the guitar, it was Cherry Red 355, he opened it up and just immediately started playing this and was like, where the heck did that come from?
Well, he did this one and he did
Girl Afraid
in the same night.
Yeah.
He, sometimes guitars have music in them. That's what he said in his book.
Yeah.
Sometimes they have music already in them. So anyway, yes. So that's the legend. And, you know, I mean, well, he said it, so I guess I'm going to have to believe him.
Yeah.
So this was their next hit single. I mean, and it's a good one. I just love the, like, the kind of, it does have a little disco-y kind of.
Also, the Top of the Pops performance for this is really good because you've got, like, Morrissey's bum bush. Yeah, at the biggest.
And then he's got the hearing aid in, right?
Yeah.
Isn't that this one where he started wearing the hearing aid?
I think so, yeah. And he's got the white and pink polka dot shirt or whatever. Pink and white.
So anyway, okay, well let's just go on to the next one.
Okay,
let's
hit it. Next one.
Okay, This Night Has Opened My Eyes. This one's interesting.
So... Okay, so, but we've already covered.
Let me read some of the lyrics real quick.
Okay.
Okay, so in a river the color of lead, immerse the baby's head, wrap her up in the news of the world, dump her on a doorstep, girl. This night has opened my eyes, and I will never sleep again. Okay.
In a
what the heck is this song about? That's the big question.
I know what it is, but I want to hear what you think.
No, I have a confession right up front. Is that originally, because like I talked about in previous podcasts, you know, I just listened to the Smiths so much I didn't bother to read the lyrics because I heard them, you know, so I thought I knew them. Sometimes I had fill in words. So I always thought it said, in a river the color of lead emerged the baby's head.
Oh.
And I thought it was get birth.
Ooh.
No, the birth canal, you know, and there's all this crap shooting out.
Oh.
It's like, I don't know if you've ever seen a live birth, but man, it's like, I mean, all this stuff flying out.
Which birth are you about? It's either a cow birth or
no.
Like an exorcist.
Yeah.
No, but I'm saying there's
no,
all
that.
That
was
there's,
his birth. That
there's
was
all
his birth.
I was there.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was like, whoa!
What is all this?
But anyway, no, there's stuff coming out. There's liquids and stuff. So
yes.
I thought the river, the color of lead, and I don't mean to, but was the, you know, the baby coming out and there's like all this liquid coming out, you know. Anyway. So I thought it was about giving birth, so it fitted with the song about, that this song was about abortion or something, you know, possibly, or,
okay.
But now it's like, okay, now it's like immersed. I was like, whoa, that totally changes everything. It's like drowning a baby.
Nope.
Okay, that's where,
all right,
Steve's all happy.
No, it isn't.
No.
Mr. Know-it-all.
No, to me, it wouldn't be immerse the baby's head as drowning it. It'd be immerse the whole baby. That to me would be drowning the baby. What this seems to me is a young mother had a baby out of wedlock. The man wanted to keep it. The mother didn't. So she had the baby baptized in the Church of England or whatever, and then gave it away.
But why was it? My question is, why is it a river? Why is it the color of lead? I mean, that's dark.
I know, because it's they don't get, so like some of the churches, they don't actually have this huge tub that they you know, push babies in. It's basically just like a little bowl, and it's like a silver bowl, and they just take water and they just sprinkle it on the kid's head.
Well, yeah, but he didn't say sprinkle it. Anyway, okay, let's not get hung up on it. But these are, some of these lines are directly from A Taste of Honey.
Yeah, that's actually because that's what this song is.
It's her story.
Yeah,
it makes sense.
He just basically rewrote like the second half of A Taste of Honey. And the reason why it opens up with In a River the Color of Lead is because it was in black and white. Like, the river just looked like lead, because, like, molten lead, because it was in black and white.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to go on a tangent here. And I'm going to say the better lyric here for the opening line would have been, and this is just me, but in a river the color of blood. Not lead, but blood.
Well, that would give my thing.
Exactly. I'm for your theory, not mine.
I know, but it wasn't immersed, it's emerged. No, wait. Mine is emerged. The way I heard it. And that would actually, but yeah, the dream is gone, but the baby is real, is a line from A Taste of Honey.
Yeah.
What dream? What dream?
The dream of having, you know, all these, being able to do what you want.
Yeah.
You know, she was a young girl.
Exactly.
So yeah, your dreams, you don't have a dream anymore because now you got a kid. But it always seemed like it was like, okay, so what's this? A grown man at 25, he said he'd cure your ills.
Is that what happened to my life?
Yeah, this one. And then the other two. There goes the dream.
There's where my dreams went.
See, but then there's like a shoeless child and a swing reminds you of your own again. See, that's what I'm saying. Sometimes it's just not connected.
He gave it away.
It's not connected.
The girl gave it away.
Oh.
Because as she's walking, you know, she wasn't ready for motherhood, so she gave away the child, but every time she sees it,
it
reminds her of her
own. Okay, so that makes sense of the lyrics, so save your life because you've only got one, you know, save your life, get rid of the kid, I mean, don't, you know, we're not talking about abortion, we're, you know, give it up for adoption, which
yeah.
was very
if
common.
If I can't provide for a kid, let somebody else
and then you can have your life back.
Yeah.
I mean, there's going to be sadness.
Yeah.
Okay, because I always thought You know, I mean, there was
but
something
again,
to do with abortion.
We should just have like a theater episode where we watch A Taste of Honey. Like,
and we, you know what we can have? Bitto Honeys when we're watching A Taste of Honey. Have you ever had a Bitto Honey?
I'd
That's Marge's favorite candy.
I know, but I just rather
have
a little bit of jar of
honey.
No, I haven't.
They're good. It's like, it gives you just a taste of honey.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah.
Just a bit of honey.
A bit of honey. That was the original title of A Taste of Honey.
Just like a tub of shake.
Okay, so I love this song, though. I love the how he does it. I don't know. The... You know, it's just this really, it reminds me, I mean, this one totally is like a 60s girl song, like the music, except for it's in Johnny Marr's style.
Yeah,
it reminds me of
It's like a haunted 60s girl pop
yeah,
song.
Yeah, but he just does it so beautifully. Like, I remember somebody was listening to this cassette of mine, and they said they loved this song, just the way it kind of flows. Like, the guitar just takes you through it, like... Anyway, it's just such a masterpiece. And then Morrissey's lyrics, that's the thing, is that, yeah, they just go well with it and stuff. And
sometimes the guitars just have songs on.
Yeah, and this one did. I want to get that guitar, see if it has any songs for me.
Yeah, you're like dumping
out. We're very fine!
It dumps out an accordion.
Like, son of a gun! You know what Picasso said? He said inspiration will usually find you working or something.
Really?
That's what Johnny Marr said.
He's not Pablo Picasso.
No, but Johnny Marr said that.
Johnny Marr said that.
Johnny Marr, that's quoting Pablo Picasso. When he was talking about the inspiration for songs, you know?
Yeah.
Anyway. But this song, okay, so any other stuff about this song?
No. Any other stuff?
It's cool. Has a nice bass.
Let's listen to some more of it.
Yeah, a little bit more, because I just love the... I love it. I don't know how he does it, but the usual tremolo thing.
Yeah, that makes me...
Well, so...
That's a good song.
It's a beautiful song. You've got everything now. We've already talked about this one.
We've already talked about
it. And there's not really anything to say. This one doesn't add anything to it.
It doesn't...
You know what? I think it takes away.
Oh, really?
Because I... Okay. Wait, in the original, on the debut album... We need to start looking over in the camera. We should put the camera over there, because we're looking.
That's what we were talking about earlier. We should do that. But
anyway, we're going to... Sorry, guys. They're like, why are they always...
Yeah. We're looking over there because...
That's where Dave is.
Yeah. Dave? What do you think? Dave, why don't you comment right down here? See, the point
right
to the
here,
camera.
Right here.
It might be right there by the time we upload. Who knows?
In the first album, it has that organ in it, that kind of rush organ.
Yeah.
Like, I love that. That's actually one thing I like about the first album, is that organ and the piano.
Yeah, no, the organ is pretty interesting, but I don't know.
That must have been a Porter touch.
I think
it's all Porter.
I think I like this version better.
John Porter.
Because it feels less
John Porter. I thought you were talking about like the brand of organ. I'm like, how can you tell the brand of organ?
Because these ears.
Yeah.
I think it was a Casio.
I really like this version more. It sounds like less campy, I want to say. Like, Reel Around the Fountain is really strong to me, like, as a song. And then it's like, oh, cool, I'm really excited to hear what this album has to offer. And then you get to, you've got everything now. And it's kind of like, there's so much energy in the song itself, but it's not really displayed in the
So the organ
production.
Takes away from it?
Yeah, I kind of feel like...
Oh, so
this,
you,
this
you
is
think
a lot
this
more
one's
like
a...
punky, I guess.
Yeah, it is. And, you know, You've Got Everything Now anyway isn't one of my favorite songs. And at all, it's one of those kind of like,
All right.
Take it or leave it. But I'm just saying, But for me, the one that you were saying, and it's coming up, is Real Around the Fountain is the one that I was like, this version, this doesn't work for me. But okay, you've got everything now. Anyway,
we've covered that, so let's just
accept it. But we've covered this. And, I need to apologize to Kaz because I got so hung up on the shoes last time. You remember he borrowed your shoes and he felt awkward in playing or whatever? Never mind.
Wait, what?
I did.
You guys don't watch the episodes, man.
Hey, I think you're rewriting history, Mark.
I remember. I was focused on it's about fashion or whatever, and it's not. It's more about, I think, in this song that Morrissey's saying, hey, don't quit sitting in your room and drawing up plans, you know, on how to find love or whatever. You need to get out there, is what he's saying. You need to accept yourself, quit, you know, whining or sitting around and doing nothing, and get
That's
out
right.
there and do
get
something.
Get
do
out
something.
There and get the donuts.
Yeah, Elise. Elise, if you're watching this, we better have donuts.
Yeah, at the catering table, we better have donuts.
Okay.
Tons of them.
So anyway, but I'm just saying, so that, and that was your take on it.
Yeah.
And I ended up agreeing with you at the end, you know?
Well.
But I was just hung up on something for some reason. Yeah.
Well, I accept your apology. Never do that again. Never.
But never question me. Okay.
Do you know who brings the props to this table?
Wait.
Yeah.
But vinyl, baby. This little makeshift box.
Yeah.
All right.
Okay.
So anyway, we.
No, accept
not,
yourself.
Yeah. So we're skipping that.
Girl Afraid.
How far are we into this? We don't even have the timer on.
I don't have the timer on, so they can just deal with it.
Okay. Girl Afraid. Okay. This, I've got something big for you guys for this one.
All right. Hold on.
He told us beforehand he had a bombshell to draw.
Yeah, because Morrissey did steal this song.
Now, did Morrissey steal it, or did Mar steal it?
Oh, Morrissey.
Skip ahead.
Oh, so he's downstairs, and she's upstairs? Interesting. Okay, pause real quick. So there's this whole thing going on with these two people, a girl and a boy.
Uh-huh. It sounds like our high school experience.
Oh, I remember one time sitting in the seminary building, and somebody I liked was in there, and I just sat there and stared. Like, so what's up? And she's like, nothing. And, you know, kind of like, I always wanted that moment, and then when the moment was there, I didn't have anything to say.
Yeah.
So, Morrissey, there's this, you know, in the room downstairs. I'm just gonna jump to it.
Let's jump to it.
Now, Johnny Marr said something about Morrissey was devouring a certain band just devouring their music.
Let me guess, it was Metallica.
He was a huge Metallica head.
Yeah, did you see that one picture?
Okay, here we go. Hopefully it's...
That's Hermits.
Yeah, I was
like... Listen.
Just one flight. A girl waits patiently. Downstairs every night. Sits as a girl listening from the floor below. Upstairs just
okay, just, we're, just give it, be patient. Okay.
Each one knows that the other is
I love this, it's so cool.
Each one hoping that the other will bear.
I'm gonna try to
walk
here. Anyway,
I like Herman's Hermits.
But I'm saying this is Girl Afraid.
Yeah, it is.
It's, I mean, you got the two levels going on, upstairs, downstairs. You got the one person saying, oh, you know, like, there's a boy up there listening to his radio, the girl's waiting patiently, and then the boy's waiting for her to do something, you know, they're waiting for somebody to make the first move. Now, of course, Herman's Hermits, at the end, they end up getting together, you know, and then all of a sudden upstairs, everything's happy, you know. But Morrissey changed it to his thing to where just nothing happens.
Well, because in the Herman's Hermits song, Morrissey left early.
No, it was Morrissey's take on it, you know. But he just kind of, yeah, he didn't put the ending in because that you don't have a happy ending in a...
No, I agree with my dad. Morrissey was late for his 5 o'clock vegan meeting.
Vegan? He's not even vegan, man. He eats eggs. Look, he's got a glass of milk right here. Unless that's silk. Or, you know, soy milk.
Almond milk.
That's it.
Okay.
Coconut milk.
Anyway, whenever I was devouring Herman's Hermits, much like Morrissey back in the 90s, and I found this album. It's on an album called Blaze, and I heard this song and I was like, "Holy crap! I can't believe it! It's Girl Afraid." So I mean, that's my thing. I was like, I've never heard anybody ever say that about this.
You know what? This is what's funny. Okay, so Mark tells us about when he was a kid. And Kaz, I'll let you talk in just a second. But it's just funny because Mark tells us about when he was a kid, he hears Girl Afraid. And then he hears, I believe it's called Upstairs, Downstairs by the Herman's Hermits. And he's like, oh, wow.
But I never told anybody.
No. He puts it together that Morrissey kind of ripped off Herman's Hermits. But kids today, they would hear the same thing and they'd be like, Herman's Hermits totally ripped off the Smiths.
Well, yeah.
Did you hear that? Man, I can't believe that.
Kaz, dude, this is directly aimed at Kaz.
No, it's not direct, it's not aimed at
this
Kaz.
Is,
but
this charming podcast, the handsome hooligans and the friends of Kaz.
I get what you're saying, but I don't think anybody who listens to the Smiths would really like jump to that conclusion right away.
But still, the kids.
Yeah, that's true.
The kids these days.
No, I understand.
And, you know,
but actually, you know what? Okay. I didn't realize. Okay, you know that song, How Can I Forget, by the Naked Eyes?
Yeah.
That Sandy Shaw did that originally.
Yeah.
And I was like, what?
Well,
They wrote it for her.
The songwriters wrote it for Sandy Shaw, and then...
Yeah. I didn't mean she wrote it, because it was Engelbert Humperdinck or something.
Yeah.
That reminds me of The Princess Bride. What was that? Humperdinck.
Yeah.
Anyway. But... He's like, quit saying that, I can't hear you! Miracle Max.
Yeah. Anyways, cool song. I like how it doesn't have a chorus. Like, I think that's really, really cool.
Yeah, it doesn't. Just kind of tells the story.
Because there's not really any moment, there's not really, like, a spark in any moment. It's just...
Well, yeah, because it's just, like, these two people, both of them...
Yeah.
Are in this stalemate because neither one's gonna make a move.
Yeah,
it doesn't deserve a chorus.
Johnny Marr's like lengthy guitar lines at the beginning, middle, they really do a good job of like being that nothingness, that stalemate, I guess. So I don't know. That's really cool.
What I like is the end. I just like the end.
Yeah. That's what I'm saying.
Like really free verby.
Yeah, and he's like, no, like nothing's going to happen. You're not going to go upstairs and meet. Like, yeah. So, yeah, that's it. Definitely.
I like the ending.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. He's like, you're not going to have that happy ending that you get in Herman Hermit's song. So.
Well, yeah. I tell you what, then we should probably go back to the old house.
Oh, yeah. Now, this one's interesting.
This one?
Yeah.
Okay.
I love this one. It seems kind of like... Here, my one turn up a little bit. But it just seems so, like...
Yeah, I know.
That's weird. Oh, that's fine. Here, just... Wait, Steve, they're coming for us. They're coming for her. They're gonna get us, man.
Let them come for us.
Holy moly. Steve, this come right out of your pocket.
Yeah.
When we got... Okay, Steve. Here, I mean, great song, though. But we probably just lost the rights to this whole show. Now it's going to be on mute the whole time.
Yeah, now,
you know they do that?
Now,
or else when you're watching, you're like, what, it's on mute? Oh, it was copyright infringement? Well, what do I say about it?
Mike Joyce actually now owns the show.
Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Welcome to Mike Joyce, the friends of Mike Joyce.
Yeah.
Or what was our superhero thing? I really want to make the cartoon. He plays the drums and we get our superpowers.
Oh, yeah.
The friends of Mike Joyce.
Yeah.
It's our Saturday morning cartoon that we're going to make. Once we get all our podcast money together.
Yeah, he eats the mushrooms and then he becomes like Magic Mike.
Yeah. The first time he met the Smiths and played with the first time he played with the Smiths, he was on mushrooms.
And
he's like, Johnny was like, something was off, and I knew it wasn't my guitar playing, and I knew that it wasn't Morrissey singing, and he goes, but something was just off, and it was before they had any work, and then they're leaving, you know, and Mike's like, oh, how'd I do, I hope I did okay, and Johnny's like, yeah, you did good, you know, and he's like, good, because I ate a bunch of mushrooms before I came.
Yeah.
So... He's like, and at that moment, I knew either this guy was really unprofessional, or he had, you know, was just didn't have it, didn't care, and I was like, I was willing to take that bet on him that he was. Anyway, they should have fired him right there. They should have fired him right
Maybe
there.
Maybe they would have had their 40%.
Yeah. No, hey Mike, my buddy, friend, I know he's watching. We have one person in the UK that's watched every episode, Mike. This is a call out to you because I know you're watching us. You can write us or whatever, and or if it's Andy Rourke, Mike Joyce, Johnny Marr, or Morrissey, I know one of you four are watching, or even if it's Craig Gannon, we'll take you too.
What about Stephen Street?
Oh no, we'll take him. We will not take Jeff Travis.
Yeah.
That guy, I saw an interview with him. He is so arrogant. He just, the way he talks, like, he's one of those know-it-all guys.
Now you just lost us, our UK viewer. Yeah.
The Jeff's like... he was our one.
Yeah, no, he's
like, they haven't said anything bad about me yet.
He's downloading all of our videos and putting them onto Vimeo now.
Free. Sorry, the friends of... No, we can't... Anyway. We can't be the friends of him. But one of you four is watching, and I'm going to call you out right now to contact us so we can have an exclusive interview.
If you
three on one. And we'll give you 25%. We will give you 25% of all the money we're getting.
Yeah.
Which is zero.
I know.
Yeah. 25% of our... triple digit that includes a decimal point.
0.00. Anyway,
we found like a nickel here.
Back to the old house. Yeah, that's true.
So when you cycled by, here began all my dreams, the saddest thing I've ever seen.
I love that line. It reminds me of being a kid, you know, because we're all riding on bicycles.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so, and there, you know, this cute girl, and just bicycling by, like, this innocent love and stuff, you know, and, but then he has all these memories and stuff, but he can't go back, he just, because there was, it wasn't all good, but sometimes you kind of glorify those times.
Yeah, no, could I interject with something that may sound crazy, but totally isn't?
Okay.
This song and Late Night Model Industry are directly connected.
Oh, yeah. Okay, that's not crazy.
That's not really crazy.
Yeah, it's, but the, he took, this song is so short, well, how long is this one?
This is 3 minutes and 3 seconds.
And then Late Night Model Industry is like seven.
Six, yeah, it's a long. Yeah, no,
but
no. This one feels much more like the Smiths version of it, and then Late Night is very much like the Morrissey solo version.
Yeah.
Like, it fits
winter.
Very well.
Winter.
Huh? What?
Are you?
I actually can't talk about the song.
Why?
I can't.
Too many bad memories?
Yeah, unfortunately, this one hits too personal for me, so I can't talk about that one.
Right.
Whoa, well, save that. It's too close to home is for meat is murder. Come on, Steve. Too near the bone, maybe?
Oh,
okay.
One more thing.
Well, okay, I just love the...
One more thing I want to add to this is if anybody ever says everything sounds better on electric guitar and there's acoustic guitars aren't good, point them to this song, because Back to the Old House, this version... is so nice and like so very melodic on the acoustic guitar, and then you listen to the Louder Than Bombs version, and it's kind of
How does it go? Anyway, we don't.
Yeah,
we'll save
it's
it
not
for
good.
Louder Than Bombs. Anyway, but it, yeah, I love it because all it is the acoustic guitar and Morrissey's vocals.
Yeah.
You know, I'm.
And only other.
I'm
one.
Sure they added something in there because they couldn't. You know, John. I don't think Johnny can just leave it alone. I bet you there's some. Extra guitar stuff in there, but...
Yeah, no. But there's only one other Smith song that only has the two of them.
What?
Asleep.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's just the piano and him.
Yeah. I guess there's also that music box
that
I have.
That was Mike Joyce playing that.
Yeah.
It was like,
I got a music box.
Yeah. Mike Joyce comes in with the drum kit, and I'm like one stand in this box.
Like, I'm earning that. Okay.
So, you know who our one viewer in the UK is? It's probably Mike Joyce's lawyer. Figuring out a whole case against us now.
Hey, man, you can have 25%. Serious, you got it.
Or it's David Cameron trying to like go underground to get his Smiths info.
Yeah.
David Cameron, the guy that was saying that he listened to the Smiths.
Yeah, he was
or whatever.
Banned from listening to the
it's
Smiths.
It's like, oh, look, this one's got 100 or, you know,
yeah.
100 views. They must know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
David, you need to go somewhere else to get your Smiths info, because...
No, he can come here. I don't care.
Hey. Just leave a comment, David.
Yeah,
that's all
exactly.
We care.
Comments.
Hey, you can get a list of the loss.
Yeah, I like
well,
how
free.
I will ship it to you. Talking to David Cameron, like we know him personally. This guy's this was the former prime minister of Britain.
Well, I know, but he wants some street cred.
Yeah.
And hey, David Cameron, if you want Smith street cred, you post on our thing. We'll make a shout out to you. Then I'll have some serious street cred.
That's right. Just three guys who are talking
hey,
on YouTube.
Why can't conservatives be Smiths fans, man?
They can't.
Johnny Marr said they can't.
That's I mean, it's just saying. Okay, so you can still like their music.
Well, that's the problem.
I heard Donald Trump's a huge Smiths fan.
No, I did not hear that. Oh, let's move on.
Donald Trump has small hands.
Yeah, Donald. Don't you wish you had a pair of these?
Hey,
they make him feel awkward.
Stop.
And
we will get in a Twitter war with Donald Trump.
He's going to call us out.
Yeah.
That's how I swear that guy, man. Anyway.
All right, Reel Around the
make
Fountain.
Make America great again.
Reel Around the Fountain.
Okay. Oh, Reel Around the Fountain.
Yeah.
This one's just here. I like the... The first album does it better.
Yeah, we actually covered this in the first album. That version and this version. We actually covered both versions.
We talked about it.
I am not sure which one I like better. Because like I like the piano in the debut version, but I also just like how kind of there it is in this one. Like, this is, this is what, the BBC John Peel session?
I have it in. It'll come up. No. It'll come up. Sorry. Keep talking about it, though.
Yeah, Cass, keep talking.
I don't know. It's just kind of.
Yeah, this is a John Peel.
There's no extra like frills or whatever. Like, there's not the weird.
I know, but I'm saying there's the part where the chorus comes in where it's like, you know, with the piano that we just love. You know, you love it.
Yeah.
I know you do.
Yeah, no.
I'm saying, but that was the influence of John Porter. I swear it was.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move.
We covered that. So let's get to the last song, which is probably one of the best songs on the album, minus How Soon Is Now.
Yeah, this one's great. This is, so I mean, simple. Shoot, we could probably play the whole thing and not even get dinged because it's so short.
No, because nobody watches.
Not because it's so short.
No,
let's just say this is so short. Yeah.
Oh, I'm still on that. Sorry.
Steve.
That was my mistake.
Good time. Alright, let's look at the camera.
See the look I've had can make a good man turn bad. So please, please, please.
Okay, now skip to the end part where we can hear the mandolin.
Hey, Italiano, who has to cook some pasta? Mangia!
All right. Beautiful song.
Yeah.
Love it.
There's where Mike Joyce earned his 25%.
He didn't do anything.
The cymbals.
Oh, he was?
I thought that was...
No, that's the guitar. That's the ringing of the guitar.
Yeah, no, because...
No, that's just
the ringing.
Sounds like the cymbals.
Listen. No! What is he going?
No. Very lightly.
No.
Maybe. There could be something.
Judges?
Ding.
All right, they like it.
Survey says.
Yeah.
I've listened to this song a lot, and because I'm trying to play it, I'm working on it on my accordion, and there will be.
music video.
There will be a video posted soon.
You want to know where we're gonna get sued for? It's gonna be that.
For playing accordion. We're like. I thought those were banned. The federal government outlawed accordions or
Trump
something.
Trump will come get us, man.
For playing the accordion. This song is... What do you like about it? Steve or Kaz?
Let's go with Kaz first.
Honestly, I don't really have a lot to say about this song. I feel like this song speaks for itself. It's so kind of like... morose, I guess. It's really sad, but like it's not a sadness where you're like, oh, you know, he is super sad. It's a sadness that kind of like brings you in. You're like, I've felt like that before, and I can really empathize, especially with that mandolin at the end. You know, it's just like, holy crap, this is where my life is. It really brings you in.
Yeah, that's it. Because there's not many lyrics to it, but he sets the tone, and all of a sudden they just let you think about it whenever the mandolin's playing. Like, let it really sink in, like, dude, you've been there, or you're there.
Yeah, the best...
I've had this thing on repeat, like, have you ever done that?
Yeah.
To where you just have, please, put on repeat. And just listen over and over again so you can get sadder and sadder.
Yeah. No, my philosophy with tracks that close out albums is that the best ones are always the ones where the album ends and you could sit there for 5 minutes afterwards just thinking about it.
That's what this one does, yeah.
Yeah. And in my mind, there are three really that do that the best, and that's actually four. That's this song, Please, 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 Rock and Roll Suicide by David Bowie, Still Life by Suede, and Asleep by The Smiths.
Wait, that's four.
I said four.
Oh. Good for you.
Yeah. Anyways, what are you trying to say, Mark?
I don't know. I thought you said three for some reason.
I did say three and then corrected myself before.
Oh, okay. I was still stuck on the three.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Live in the now, Mark. Stop bringing up the past.
Okay. I will live in the now. I'm going to go get that girl.
Hey, Mark doesn't live at the old house on Maudlin Street. He's always asking, please, 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 let me get what I want.
Yeah, I'm polite at least.
And then he comes back and says, how soon is now?
How soon is now, you handsome devil? I'm going to put my hand in this glove. Oh, I'm still ill. Like, trying to make it all sense.
That's what we should do. In the comments, try to make a full, coherent sentence out of all of the Hatful of Hollow songs.
Okay, that's going to be tough. You
don't have to... Okay, so you don't
can
have
you
to...
Can you add a few words, though?
You can add a
you
few...
You can add a few words.
Few that's, words and try
okay, guys... And if you can do that, we're going to pick the best, and they're going to get the list of the lost.
Don't do that. Nobody will comment. They're like, no way, man.
Guys, I will ship it to anywhere in the world to get it out of my hands into yours.
I will pay shipping. I will pay double shipping.
Please, just get this out of my house.
Shipping.
Let's open it up.
Watch Morrissey.
Will
the
muddled media frenzied about... with expertly worried brows over the Watergate cover-up,
oh,
adding
goodness.
Their own fake fury and mania to turbulence.
This sounds like
and
the
greed.
Vogons. The Vogon
it
poetry.
Does. It does sound like that.
It's just... Morrissey! Why?
Morrissey.
But anyway, so we're calling you guys out, though. Whoever you are in the UK watching, you don't have any friends in the UK, do you?
I might.
No, you don't.
I don't.
Morrissey, Mar, Mike, or
actually,
Andy.
Actually, Kaz might.
No, Kaz.
I do, but I don't think I've told anyone about this, at least in the UK.
Oh, well, thanks a lot. Then, yeah, we'd hate for the word to get out or anything.
I want to wait. I want to wait until we get that interview with Mike Joyce. That's what the people want.
The interview with Mike Joyce?
Yeah.
That's already done, dude.
We haven't uploaded it yet.
I know. I'm scared. Anyway, so add a comment, and if you do want the list of the lost, I'll send it to you.
If you don't want the
or
list
hand
of
it
the
to
lost,
you if it's my brother.
I'm gonna comment on it.
No, Steve, and disclaimer, friends and family, you know, like they do, and
yeah.
All the other.
If you are a member of the Smith's cast or a family.
No, if you were. Are a handsome hooligan, you can't have it. Sorry,
yeah.
Kaz.
Ah.
Or Steve. You're going to have to buy it yourself.
What about if you're a member of the Smiths?
You can have it. And if you're Morrissey?
Take it back.
Yeah.
Please.
Please. Take it away. Anyway, so next... So, okay, does that wrap up?
Yeah.
We're done.
We're
so,
done with Hatful of Hollow.
The next album...
Woo! Oh.
...is going to be... Nita's Murder.
The next album, huh?
So, what are you doing, Steve? Steve's got to do something crazy.
Oh, no.
Anyway.
No! The next album.
Is going to be a minor
no!
terrible thing to taste.
Okay, how about this then?
No, Steve,
no, listen,
wait, we gotta end this, dude.
No, hold on.
Jesus built my hot rod.
This one.
How about Stigmata? Thunderstruck.
This is the tech.
No, okay, Steve.
What? I cut it.
Okay.
I cut it.
No, I'm just saying, let's end this out.
Oh, yes.
Let's end it out with please.
Let's do that. Cast.
And then we'll get out of here. We'll quit bugging you. I don't know how far we're into this. We're probably well over an hour.
Oh, gosh.
Good time.
All right, guys. So next time, listen to Come Prepare, do your homework, and any comments, get this awesome novel.
Yeah.
And so we're... The Handsome Hooligan signing off from this charming podcast. finally finished Hatful of Hollow and feel good job, guys.
Alright.
Yeah.
So, till next time.
Farewell.
We'll see you.
I'm not gonna add anything.
Okay, fine. Don't then.
Yeah, I'm the edgy guy.
You're the edgy guy.